Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Bob Trug. I'm the director of the Center for Bioethics at Harvard Medical School, and I'd like to welcome you to our Health Policy and Bioethics Consortium, which is part of a series of events that is organized and led by Dr. Aaron Kesselheim, who will be speaking to you in just a moment. I just wanted to, first of all, thank you for being here. And also put in a little plug that the Center for Bioethics has something organized on almost every Friday from 12:30 to 2 in this time slot. And we rotate between a clinical ethics consortium, research ethics consortium, health policy and bioethics consortium, and an organizational ethics consortium. So if you block out that time slot in your calendar, you'll always have something to do and a free lunch on Fridays. If you're not on our mailing list and you'd like to be, please go to our website and let us know. And again, thank you for being here, and I hope to see you at ones in the future. So, Aaron?
All right, well, thanks, Bob, and thanks to the entire Harvard Medical School Center for Bioethics staff for helping put this together, and thanks to you all for coming out. It's really a pleasure to see so many people here at our inaugural meeting of this. Of the seminar series. This is the first of the year. This is a set of them that we are organizing through my group, the Program on Regulation, Therapeutics and Law. Portal is a research core within the Division of Pharmacoepidemiology and Pharmacoeconomics at Brigham and Women's Hospital. We have two full-time faculty. Amit is here. A number of us, additional affiliated faculty. We have a number of great postdocs who work with us as well, and numerous students. And our focus is on the intersection of law, therapeutics, and public health, which is what drew us to try to organize this this session. Our budget is generally funded by the funders you can see up there: the Laura and John Arnold Foundation, Commonwealth Foundation, Harvard Program in Therapeutic Science. I want to particularly thank for their support as well. And we run courses in addition to this, which is a course for some of the students at the Center for Bioethics. Amit runs a course on public health law at the School of Public Health. I run a course in FDA law at Yale Law School. And you can follow us on Twitter, I hear, at portal_research. So I just want to make sure you guys mark your calendars for upcoming ones of these. I'll say this at the end, but in case people have to leave early. Our session next month is on international trade and access to medicines, a discussion of public health concerns about high-cost medicines and international trade agreements with Tom Boyke from the Council of Foreign Relations and Amy Kaczynski from Yale Law School. And then we're going to talk about the hope and hype of precision medicine in November with Sandro Gallier, who's the dean of the Boston University School of Public Health, and Cal McRae, who's the chief cardiovascular medicine at the Brigham. Okay, but today we're here to talk about the ethical involvement of patients in the FDA regulation of new products, and we are honored to have two expert discussants who have come in to share their experience and expertise with us. Diana Zuckerman is the president of the National Center for Health Research, a nonprofit research and educational organization that conducts and analyzes research and uses the results to improve the policies and programs affecting the health of adults and children. She has testified about the safety and efficacy of medical and consumer products dozens of times before Congress, federal agencies, state legislative committees, and even the Canadian Parliament. She trained in epidemiology and public health at Yale Medical School and worked for a dozen years as a congressional staffer as well as a senior policy advisor to First Lady Hillary Clinton. In her current position, she's also a fellow at the University of Pennsylvania Center for Bioethics and was the first non-physician elected to the Women in Medicine International Hall of Fame. She previously chaired Maryland's Women's Health Promotion Council and currently serves on CMS's Medicare Evidence Development and Coverage Advisory Committee and the Board of Directors of the Reagan-Udall Foundation and the Alliance for a Stronger FDA. We also have Waleed Galad. Dr. Galad is an Associate Professor of Medicine and Health Policy at the University of Pittsburgh, where he leads the Center on Pharmaceutical Policy and Prescribing. His research focuses on physician prescribing practices and on policy issues affecting access and adherence to medications for patients. He was the recipient of career development awards from the Department of Veterans Affairs and is currently funded by the VA, NIH, CDC, and State of Pennsylvania in multiple studies of pharmaceutical policy and prescription use. He's a former member of the FDA Advisory Committee on Non-Prescription Drugs and was, important for this panel, a member of the FDA Advisory Committee that reviewed flibanserin in 2015. Dr. Glad is board certified in internal medicine and completed a residency and chief residency. We were actually residents together in internal medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital at Harvard Medical School. So a little bit of background for today's conversation. So under the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act of 1938, clinical evidence for investigational new drugs must be collected before prescription drugs can be sold to the public. And the statutory requirements for the development of these of this information is that the information must provide substantial evidence of efficacy for the intended use of the product that arises from adequate and well-controlled investigations. And the safety of the product must also be established to the FDA by adequate tests, by all methods reasonably applicable to show whether or not the drug is safe for such use. I'm sure most people in the room know that in order to get a drug approved and to demonstrate efficacy and safety, the testing requires preclinical studies, as well as phase 1, 2, and 3 clinical trials, which are the different increasing complexity of clinical trials that an investigational drug goes through. Phase 1 trials, usually in healthy volunteers, or single dose studies, providing some evidence of the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics related to the drug. Phase 2 trials are in a larger population, usually in among patients with the disease indicated to treat. It may provide some evidence of the some initial look into the efficacy of the product. And the phase 3 clinical trials are these larger, much more complex comparative studies that provide evidence of the efficacy of the product. And then after this information is collected, it's submitted to the FDA, where determining whether a drug's benefit outweighs its risk can involve dozens of FDA scientists poring over extensive databases of studies in animals, toxicologic evaluations, and clinical trials. Now, the FDA doesn't always do all of this internally. In fact, there is this process where the FDA can call on outside advisory committees, which are technical committees of outside experts, to comment on the data as well. These days, in addition to technical experts, advisory committees usually include at least one consumer representative and now usually include at least one patient representative as well. The advisory committees provide advice on the approvability of specific products, scientific and policy issues they confront, and it provides a public forum for the discussion of controversial issues. There are 51 different advisory committees across the FDA, and these advisory committees make non-binding recommendations to the FDA about the questions that the FDA has put to it regarding the data that emerges on the trial. And there's some data suggesting that FDA follows advisory committee recommendations about 3/4 of the time. In addition to these expert advisory committees, there are a number of ways now that there are intersections between patients and the drug approval process. So one might be through patient-reported outcomes, which are measures that patients will provide in the course of studying a drug, that they're sort of the patient's assessment of the medical product's effects, and can be used as a way of examining the outcomes of the drug. The FDA released some guidance on this relatively recently, describing what sort of patient-reported outcomes, how they're integrated into the clinical investigation process. And in recent years, from about 20 submissions a year, that might include patient-reported outcomes prior to this, currently about over 100 different submissions to the FDA a year include some amount of patient-reported outcomes as part of their clinical information that's provided to the FDA in evaluating investigational drugs. Other ways that the FDA intersects with patients in the review process is through the Patient-Focused Drug Development Initiative, which was established in 2012 to try to systematically gather patients' perspectives on their condition and available therapies to treat their condition. And as part of that, the FDA has held 24 different meetings with different patient groups over the last 5 years. There's the FDA Patient Network, in which the FDA puts out information to patients, and there's a publication called Patient Network News. There's a Patient Engagement Advisory Committee that advises the FDA Commissioner on complex issues related to regulation, so it's basically an advisory committee made up entirely of patient stakeholders. And then, of course, in addition to this more specific process about patients' involvement in the evaluation of particular products, there are other ways that patients can become involved in the regulatory process. For example, when the FDA puts out a new rule that may affect the availability of products, there is a notice and comment process where anyone from the public can provide commentary on the rule, and then the FDA has to respond to the commentary as part of the rulemaking procedure. And then there are things called citizens' petitions, where that allow people to raise issues to the FDA that they want that they think the FDA needs to evaluate about their regulatory process, and then the FDA has to respond to them. So what we want to do is talk about this intersection and dynamic between the FDA and patients in the context of two recent cases. The first being flibanserin, which Waleed will provide a lot more detail on, but I just wanted to introduce very quickly. Flibanserin was a failed antidepressant that was repurposed to treat a condition called hypoactive sexual desire disorder in premenopausal women, a condition for which there are no other approved treatments. However, the first two efficacy studies failed to show any benefit, and along with substantial safety concerns, the initial application was not approved. At that point, the drug was acquired by a small manufacturer from the large manufacturer, Boehringer Ingelheim, who was studying it. It was acquired by a smaller manufacturer called Sprout, and conducted a new efficacy trial showing a statistically significant but numerically small treatment differences compared with placebo. And there you can see the level of the difference that the newer study showed, an increase of 0.3 on this female sexual function index desire subscale that they used. Again, the range of the subscale was from 1.2 to 6, and an increase of about 0.5 satisfying sexual events per month on average. In addition to conducting these additional studies, Sprout launched a new advocacy group called Even the Score, which conducted an intense promotional campaign directed at journalists, women, Congress, and the FDA, including sending the FDA more than 24 letters, some accusing the FDA of sexism, from various advocacy organizations and researchers. And so they had an advisory committee meeting regarding this product. And here is a report from the New York Times on what that advisory committee meeting was like. That campaign, which packed the advisory committee meeting room with the drug supporters, apparently helped tip the balance for flibanserin, which had been rejected twice by the FDA. Thursday's meeting included nearly 2 hours of testimony from the public, an unusually large amount, with most speakers urging approval. Many were from organizations in the Even the Score coalition. Their remarks were loudly applauded, as was the final vote in favor of approval. And then the second case is the case of eteplirsen, which is an investigational product intended to treat Duchenne muscular dystrophy. I would point out that the FDA ultimately did end up approving flibanserin. Duchenne muscular dystrophy is a degenerative fatal disease of mostly male children, and is, of course, a very substantial unmet medical need. It's caused by a failure of the protein dystrophin as a result of a stop codon in the production of it. And the eteplirsen product was intended to be an exon-skipping drug that would allow the muscle to recover some functional dystrophin protein and therefore to prevent the loss of muscular activity in the kids. So the clinical trials that were completed and submitted to FDA included an initial proof of concept phase 1 style study, single dose study, and a dose finding study in 19 patients that ranged from 0.5 to 20 mg per kg for the product. And then a final single double-blind placebo-controlled phase 2 study that lasted initially 24 to 48 weeks included 12 patients, and then an open-label extension that followed these patients for up to 4 years, with 4 patients receiving the 30 mg per kg dose, 4 patients receiving the 50 mg per kg dose, and 4 patients receiving a placebo. So the data on eteplirsen was controversial, and their primary endpoints of the trial were generally not met. There was no change in dystrophin production at 12 weeks in the 50 mg per kg cohort, although there was a statistically significant increase at 24 weeks for the 30 mg per kg cohort. And then the functional endpoint did not show a statistically significant difference in the six-minute walk test at 48 weeks. However, within that kind of general negative picture, there were some positive signs that this drug may have some effect. So if you excluded two of the patients that lost functional activity pretty quickly in their process, and you can see that in the graph on the left, actually the difference there was a statistically significant difference at 48 weeks, although, of course, this is a post hoc change to the study design, which has its own problems. And then, of course, if you look at the 4-year data as compared to a set of historical controls, the blue line being the eteplirsen line and the yellow line being the historical control, you can see that there does seem to be some evidence of benefit in terms of maintained six-minute walk distance for the patients who had been receiving this product for this time. But of course, there were a number of questions related to the data collection process, questions about the assay process, questions about the correlation between the amount of dystrophin observed and the six-minute walk test results, which you can see on the right there, that there isn't really a correlation between increases in dystrophin level and six-minute walk test. And then the FDA presented some reanalyses of the historical control data, which if you account for the age of the patient at the time that they started treatment, and actually, you know, shows that the differences may actually not be there. Because of this controversy about the data, an advisory committee was organized. I was one of the members of the advisory committee. And the advisory committee included 52 public commentators that went on for who talked for about the public comment session went on for about four plus hours. 51 of those commentators spoke in favor of approval. And here is just a report from the Stat News article about the committee. They report that the session was easily one of the most politically charged FDA advisory panel meetings. Among them was one boy who appeared with his mother and testified before the crowd. "I'm going to beat this bloody disease, but I need your help," he told the panel, prompting cheers and applause from the overflow audience. "FDA, please don't let me die early." One Wall Street analyst believes no one should be surprised if the FDA does approve the drug. "Everyone was visibly moved by the audience and their testimony, and that is not going to go unnoticed," said Stephen Brozak. "It's not just political pressure. It's advocacy pressure of the sort that I've not seen since the days of HIV and AIDS." So this drug remains unapproved as of yet. More data was requested by the FDA of the sponsor. So our charge for today is to talk a little bit about this process and this maybe we're seeing a trend, maybe we're not, of involvement of patients and patient advocacy groups in the FDA deliberation process and whether or not it is being optimally organized and how it can be optimally organized. And I'm hoping that this can be a very interactive discussion after a few initial comments from our expert panel. We're going to try to get conversation, sort of moderated conversation with the audience early on so that your questions aren't just held until the very end. But what I don't want to do is I don't want to relitigate the approval decision or, you know, to talk about whether or not it was correct for the FDA to approve or not approve flibanserin, but to talk about the process by which the FDA gets there. And these are some of the questions that I want people to think about as Waleed and Diana talk. How should patients contribute to the FDA evaluation of investigational drugs? What are the different points in the drug review process when patient voices are most useful? How should individual patient voices be weighed against accumulated data about a drug? How should we consider financial relationships between patient advocacy groups and industry sponsors? And should we be trying to more proactively educating patients to equip them to engage in discussions about trial design, statistics, and evaluation? So with that introduction, I wanted to bring Waleed up, who is going to talk about his expertise and experience with the flibanserin discussion.
All right, well, it's great to be here. This is a great crowd, and it's a great topic, so I'm really happy to be here. I'm just going to give a little bit more background on flibanserin, a little bit over what Aaron had said, and then just a few of my thoughts to get people started thinking about the role of patients with flibanserin. So flibanserin, and I'm going to go, Aaron mentioned some of these, so I'll go quickly, but flibanserin, the brand name is Addy, was approved a year ago for the treatment of premenopausal women with HSDD, which is this hypoactive sexual desire disorder. And it was quite controversial. And in the end, the approval required very strict REMS, which are risk evaluation mitigation strategies, with ITASU is what the FDA name is, which is elements to assure safe use. And so the FDA required both prescribers and pharmacies to be certified before they could prescribe this drug. And they also had a black box warning for alcohol. So it was quite strict. And I think there have been very, very few prescriptions since it's been prescribed. But there was a controversy whether or not flibanserin was long overdue or a grievous error on behalf of the FDA. So let me just give you a little more detail about the regulatory history. In 2009, and Aaron mentioned some of this, it was the first FDA submission, and it failed in the efficacy trials, at least one of the primary endpoints. There were two primary endpoints. One was positive, one was not, and the secondary endpoints were positive. The advisory committee met, voted 11-0 no, and the drug was rejected. It was then sold and resubmitted with one new efficacy trial in 2013, using what had been a secondary endpoint, now as a primary endpoint. And so both co-primary endpoints were now positive, statistically significant. But the FDA raised still safety concerns. And overall, the issue was the drug had modest benefits, lots of safety concerns, and so it was rejected. There was an appeal, and as you can see, the appeal was rejected. So the FDA came back in its complete response letter and said, come back with some more safety data. We'll have an advisory committee meeting, and we'll see what happens. So I'll get to 2015 in a moment. This is the efficacy data. The leader of the endocrine division at the FDA actually wrote a prospectus, Hilton Jaffe, who actually was a resident, I believe, at the Brigham. They went over a lot of the data. And here's the efficacy data for flibanserin. And here's the satisfying sexual events. So this is over the three phase three trials. From a baseline of 2 to 3, over placebo, there's 0.5 to 1 additional satisfying sexual event per month. And then you can see, again, these other scales related to desire and distress, which had statistically significant effects, but very small. Okay, so that's the bottom line about the efficacy. The FDA does what they call a responder analysis. And what they found is after accounting for placebo, about 8 to 13% of women were at least much improved. Okay, so that gives you a different way of looking at efficacy than just the average effects. About 1 in 10 women reported being much improved after taking this drug. So that's an important point to remember. There were a lot of safety effects. The risk of sedation was quite high. More than a quarter of women taking the drug had some sedation-related side effect. Which is why it's taken at night. There was a lot of concern about the risk of syncope or passing out, but the rates were actually quite low in the pivotal trials and the same between flibanserin and placebo. But the problem was these are healthy women who otherwise all of a sudden could just pass out. It could happen right after the med. It could happen a few hours after the medicine. There was a significant interaction with alcohol. And like any FDA, any trial for a new drug, they were limited to healthy women, not on other sedating meds. The duration of the trial was short, and there were a lot of concerns about off-label use. And we'll talk more about the off-label use later. Okay, so in 2015, the drug was resubmitted to the FDA. There was no new efficacy data. There were two safety studies. One was a next-day driving study. And they found that there was no impairment in driving the next day. And the other was this interaction, this alcohol interaction study, where they gave 25 people alcohol, and they saw it greatly increased the risk of side effects. It happened that 23 of those were men, which was one of the problems with the data. But the advisory committee the advisory committee voted 18-6, this time yes, to approve the drug. And the drug went on to be approved after actually a lot of debate within the FDA. So what happened between 2013 and 2015? Okay, and Aaron mentioned some of these. In 2014 was this FDA meeting on female sexual dysfunction, which I'll get into. And after it was rejected in 2013, there was a new advocacy group called Even the Score that formed that did a lot of advocacy around getting this drug passed, which we'll talk about. Now, I'm not saying there's a cause and effect. I'm just saying this happened. Okay? So the three items when I think about the role that patients played, actually a large role with flibanserin, one was this this workshop, this patient-focused drug development and public meeting on female sexual dysfunction, and I'll talk more about that in a minute, even the Square Advocacy campaign, and then the actual advisory committee meeting with written and public testimony, which I'll just give you some thoughts about from my own experience. So this drug development public meeting, this was actually the FDA agreed in the reauthorization of PDUFA, which is the Prescription Drug User Fee Act, they agreed to hold a bunch of these meetings about conditions for which there were not great therapies or for which the therapies didn't really impact the symptoms that patients feel. So they looked at Chagas disease. They looked at a lot of others, which I can't remember, but fibromyalgia, psoriasis, and then female sexual dysfunction was one of these. So, and you can look at the report if you want online. This is, they wrote a report that came out in June of last year. And here are the topics. So the effect of female sexual dysfunction that matters most to patients. What do they feel like are the most distressing symptoms associated with female sexual dysfunction? And then what are their perspectives on treatment? What have they tried? What do they look for in a treatment that works? What's their ideal treatment? So this was a summary from the report that I thought would be useful for us to read, for me to read, and for you to read also. But I think it's telling. So what this was a section from the report. It said, many participants and docket commentators described a distinct transition from a prior fulfilling sex life to a total loss of interest or arousal, regardless of their varying beliefs about the causes or triggers of their interest. Participants stressed the significant distress that caused. They described never initiating sexual contact, the measures they took to avoid intimacy, and persistent anxiety. Okay. They further described the profound impact their FSD, female sexual dysfunction, has on their relationships, their self-identity, and their emotional well-being. Okay, and so when you think, and so you're in a meeting, and this is now a voice, a person telling you this, which is very different from you reading in a textbook saying that this bothers women. Okay, and I think that's one of the lessons and the dynamic that comes out of these meetings. So there was the Even the Score campaign. I'm not going to go into a lot, but I'll tell you a few things. Here's the logo. They got together many groups that were interested in this topic. The National Consumers League was included, many women's health groups. And what I love is they also had the manufacturer of the drug here in the purple, which is probably by design. But they organized consumers and women's groups. They were very effective. Letters to Congress, letters to the FDA, personal appeals, op-eds. And their main message was this, was that there are 26 treatments for men for sexual dysfunction and one for women. And it's time to even the score. That was the gist of the campaign. So completely disingenuous. The FDA hated this, and I think it's disingenuous. The problem is there are actually no approved treatments for men for sexual dysfunction, for decreased desire in men. And there are many of these 26 drugs for men are different preparations of testosterone. So it was kind of a disingenuous claim, but it was very effective. And so we had the public meeting, the Even the Score campaign, and the advisory committee meeting. And just a few thoughts on this. There was a lot of written testimony which advisory committee members were asked to read beforehand. And it was extensive. And I'll say in some cases it was really quite personal. Okay, and the public testimony the same. And I remember a man coming to talk about how this condition had destroyed his marriage and how he was worried it was going to destroy his daughter's marriage because his daughter had the same thing. There were others talking about how this had ruined their lives. And in some cases, you knew that Sprout had paid for them to come talk. And in other cases, at least one I can remember out of the many speakers, it was clear that Sprout did not pay for them to come talk. But there was heartfelt emotion, I will tell you, among the speakers, and there was courage to really talk about this topic in front of the entire world. So in some cases, the public speakers spoke directly to the male panelists. And this is something maybe we can talk about, the dynamic between having the public involved and having people making decisions. But this was very interesting to have someone standing there looking at you saying, you know, think about what you're doing. There was silent but visible disagreement. And I'll tell you, initially I had on here snarky comments, but my wife told me, you know, put this. But that's essentially what it was that you would look out in the audience when someone was talking, and then you would see the faces that people would make if someone was criticizing the drug, the kind of, you know, the sarcastic looks, in some cases hisses. I mean, it was a really interesting dynamic when you looked at people speaking and when people disagreed. And of course, there was the applause that Aaron had mentioned. So just a few thoughts maybe for the discussion later. So what did patient involvement do? It, without a doubt, increased attention to the drug. It did provide an important point of view. Okay? It gave a sense of the level of risk some women were willing to take to have the treatment available. And they're telling you this face to face. And it gave a human element for what a statistically significant benefit on average means. And I think that was really the point of having the patient there involved in the meeting. It has the possibility, and it did influence the perception of benefit. Ultimately, the FDA is making a risk-benefit trade-off. And if their sense is that there's more benefit, then that helps with the approval of the drug. And I think that was the point of having women come and talk. Obviously, we'll talk about whether it provides a selective point of view, whether it biases or pressures the FDA and panel participants. And here's, so I'll end with this, which I thought, when I thought about flibanserin, I thought this is one of the issues that we should probably talk about. So for the committee, off-label use was a huge concern. This drug is going to be approved. It's going to be used by lots of women who don't really need it. People are going to fall over and die. But for a given patient who needs the drug, why do they care? And I think when you have patients saying that they're willing to take the risk, then the issue about off-label use is really about what physicians are doing, and it's maybe not so much about what patients care about. And so I think it's just one of the issues where having the patient involved gave a different sense of what of how people should be thinking about the drug. Okay, so I'll leave it there. We can talk more later. But yeah, great.
All right, so I guess I'd ask people to hold on their questions. We're going to have Diana come up and give her presentation, and then we're going to bring both panelists up and have some discussion after that.
Thanks very much. I'll start out by saying that my center was one of the few that had speakers at the flibanserin hearings speaking about evidence-based medicine and our concern that this was a drug that not only should not be approved, but that it would set a dangerous precedent. But I'm not going to talk more about flibanserin. I'm going to talk more about the general issues of how FDA approval works, what's the role of the advisory committees, what's the role of patients, and I'm actually going to go a little further and talk about what your role could be, not necessarily as a patient, but as a health professional or as a researcher or as someone who cares about the quality of products that are approved by the FDA. So to go over this very briefly, as you've heard, the FDA makes decisions on whether the benefits outweigh the risks for most patients. And then the question is, who decides what's the, how important is the benefit? How important is the risk? How do you quantify that? And the fact that your voice, whether you're a patient or a family member or a health professional or a researcher, can be part of that process. So just to go over the process briefly, companies pay big shots to conduct the studies. The companies pay academic researchers from Harvard if they possibly can, and if they can't get Harvard, they'll settle for Yale or Stanford or someplace else to do the studies for them. But the companies are not just paying for the studies, they're controlling them to some extent. They're doing the design. They're making sure that the analysis is what they want it to be. And then the FDA scientists review the data. They don't review the raw data. That's really an honor system. They're reviewing the data that are provided to them by the company. And that's when, after that analysis is done, that is when, if there's going to be a public advisory committee, that's when it takes place. For a couple of hours, the company is going to praise their product and present all their data in PowerPoints and say how great their product is. Then the FDA scientists have a couple of hours that to either agree or disagree with what the company has said. Sometimes they've reanalyzed the data and they interpret it differently. Sometimes they reanalyze the data and they agree completely or somewhere in between. And then there's usually about 1 hour of public comments. At the flibanserin hearing, it was 2 hours. I've actually been to a meeting where it was an entire day of public comments, but it's usually an hour or less, and usually each person speaking gets 5 minutes or less. Sometimes it's 3 minutes, and that could be time for me to speak. I've done that more times than I care to mention, or it could be any of you, or it can be patients. Anybody can sign up to give a public comment. You are supposed to sign up in advance. But most of them are going to have a conflict of interest. The vast majority of speakers have been brought there. You know, who wants to go to Silver Spring, Maryland? It's a very nice town. But, you know, are you going to fly in at your own expense to talk about a product? Probably not. But if somebody pays you, and that's often the company, or somebody working with the company, such as the Even the Score campaign, if they'll pay your way in and pay for your hotel and train you on how to do this, you're just much more likely to do it. So then after those presentations, there's approximately 2 hours, and this is all you know, approximate, because these meetings are sometimes 2 days long. They're sometimes a whole day. Sometimes they're less than a day. There'll be about 2 hours for advisory committee members to ask questions, to discuss what they've heard. And then at the end, almost always, they will vote. And there'll be several votes usually, but one of them is taken as whether they recommend approval or not, although usually the votes described as, do you think the benefits outweigh the risk for most patients? And there also can be votes that are quite specific about restrictions. And you heard about REMS, which are restrictions on usually on training, or should there be a black box warning. So it can be quite nuanced. So there's one vote, and that's what the media usually pays attention to. You know, is this a good product or not? Is this worthy of approval or not? And then there are caveats. With flibanserin, just to say, this is a drug that has to be taken every day for the rest of your life if you've got this problem. So it's not that, it's not like Viagra where you take it once whenever you need it. This is taken every day. If you're not supposed to drink, that means you can't drink alcohol every day. If it's giving you a risk on being sleepy the next day, it's every day. So they try to have restrictions that are quite clear. Is this something that if you take this drug and you shouldn't do something else? For flibanserin, part of the training is, I was told, about a 3-minute video that the doctors have to watch on how they should tell their patients, you must not drink alcohol. Then as part of the meeting, so to consider this, how can the patients or the public, they can express their views during the meeting. They can write written comments that are provided to the advisory committee before the meeting. Some advisory committee members are going to read those comments. A lot of them are not. The joke about FDA advisory committee meetings is the people who are best prepared on the panel are the ones that had the longest flight to the meeting. They're the ones, and it's the local folks who might not have read much of anything. The media also expresses their views. You saw some examples of that. And the public can also talk to Congress about what Congress should do. Should Congress get involved in the case of flibanserin, for example, and in the case of the drug for Duchenne's muscular dystrophy? Quite a few members of Congress have, in fact, contacted the FDA saying, our constituents say you should approve this drug. And so Congress does tell FDA what they think, and usually that's based entirely on what their constituents have told them. If their constituents are patients, that's one thing. If their constituents are faculty members at Harvard, that is something else. But whoever their constituents are, Congress will usually pass along those concerns. And then FDA makes its decision whether to approve the product or not. In our case, our center frequently speaks at these public meetings, and we are the ones talking about the science during those public comment periods. We talk about how generalizable the data are. Do the data include enough women? Do they include enough people of color? Are they including people over 65 who are, not in the case of flibanserin, but in other cases, are the people most likely to be using the drugs and also are going to be the basis of whether Medicare is going to reimburse for it. Are the data long-term enough? You know, are they studying a drug for 3 months that's going to lower cholesterol, for example, and it's going to be taken by people for decades? And are there enough patients in the study, not just enough women or people of color, but enough patients at all? In some cases, there might be thousands of patients in the study. In other cases, there might be 60. I've seen studies with 24, and actually the one with Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, as you know, had 12. So these numbers really vary, and we talk about that. And then we also talk about how meaningful the outcomes were. You know, and that should be meaningful not just to patients, but to scientists. It should be both. If you're looking at what are called surrogate endpoints or biomarkers, we're kind of used to that, but it's not the same thing as looking at length of survival, in the case of a cancer drug, for example, looking at quality of life looking at a number of days in the hospital. And now, with the FDA being pushed a lot to approve drugs more quickly, there are various fast tracks or expedited reviews, which often rely on just one study instead of two clinical trials, and often rely on biomarkers such as cholesterol levels, glucose levels, bone mineral density, and tumor shrinkage. We're so used to these now that we think of them as health measures, but they're not really meaningful health measures to the patient unless it affects their actual health. And how can we be sure that a biomarker is going to translate to improved health? A recent study published in JAMA Oncology and authored by someone from the National Cancer Institute found that most new cancer drugs that were approved because they shrunk tumors, but when they did studies after the product was on the market, most of these did not improve survival at all. I'm going to just, if I can figure out how to do this, I'm going to show you just an example of not just an ad, but the way that patients are being...
For adults with an advanced lung cancer called squamous non-small cell, previously treated with platinum-based chemotherapy, it's not every day something this big comes along. A chance to live longer. With Opdivo. Nivolumab. Opdivo is the first and only immunotherapy FDA approved based on a clinical trial demonstrating longer life for these patients. In fact, Opdivo significantly increased the chance of living longer versus chemotherapy.
So I won't do this through the whole thing, but I feel better already. You know, this is a chance to live longer. I will take that. I don't have lung cancer, but you know, it's just very moving. And this is part of the way the emotions are used of patients who are told this drug, whatever it is, will give you that chance. And that chance might be a 1% chance. It might be a 90% chance. They're not necessarily quantifying the chance. So as a result of this kind of emotion, we've seen this a few times where the advisory committee very frequently says, yes, we want to approve this product. FDA should approve this product. Often the physicians on the panel are saying, we need more options. If there's a patient representative on the panel, usually the patient's going to say, we need options. The consumer representatives often are also saying that. Center actually did a study comparing who votes what way. For the most of the time, at least 80% of the drugs in advisory committee and devices, they recommend approval. And then they sometimes compromise when the data aren't very good with some restrictions, such as training requirements. But a lot of times those restrictions are unenforceable. I'll just give one example. Accutane, which is for acne, had a restriction that it could not be given to teenage girls who might be pregnant, and that if you wanted to prescribe it for a teenage, well, actually any young woman, you had to have, she had to have a pregnancy test. And what they found was there were doctors that were changing the name of the women to make it look like they were boys, and they were checking, instead of female, they were checking male, so that they wouldn't have to require a pregnancy test, and they would prescribe the drug anyway. So, gee, it's hard to believe doctors would do such a thing, but sometimes they do. So when you have a drug approved that's still really experimental and you don't know exactly how safe and effective it is, the patients are basically paying that for that drug to be guinea pigs. The company has little incentive to complete any post-market required studies, and these ineffective new products can cost a lot of money. With these cancer drugs that are now known to not improve survival, the most expensive of them was $169,000 a year, and most of the average cost was about $95,000 a year. Just quickly to say, device approval criteria are even worse. These low-risk devices aren't tested at all. The moderate-risk devices are not tested in clinical trials It's only the highest risk devices, such as a pacemaker, an artificial heart, an infusion pump. These are the ones that are tested in clinical trials, and only one, not two. And sometimes those trials lack a control group. This has life and death implications. Almost half a billion of these moderate devices that weren't tested in clinical trials were recalled as high risk a year ago, including the contaminated alcohol swabs that killed this little boy. So in conclusion, the FDA decisions have impact on our life and death decisions. The gold standard of two double-blind randomized clinical trials studying patients' actual health outcomes is an endangered species. The outcome measures are often surrogate outcomes, and the FDA often hears from industry, and they hear from patients affiliated with industry, but they're not hearing from you. So, we want you. We want healthcare professionals, as well as patients and ethicists and researchers, to bring their perspectives to this process. And if you have no financial ties to the product that's being considered, and if you focus on the evidence, you're almost a unique voice in that room, but a very, very important one. And as they used to say in the 60s, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Thank you very much.
All right, so I'd like to invite our panelists to come up to the front. And I want to engage our first set of sort of predetermined questions. Questions for today. Okay. So I want us first to consider citizens' roles at the FDA. I found a nice review article about the ways that public can participate in democracy. There are three questions of institutional design related to citizen participants in governance. The first question is, who should go if citizens are going to engage with the FDA or any governance? And so this is kind of a spectrum of different ways that citizens can involve the FDA. So on the more inclusive side of the spectrum, you have the kind of open self-selection process, which I take it is kind of where we are now with regard to patient participation with FDA advisory committee panels. But you can also imagine that there is an open targeted recruiting process where you try to make sure that there are particular people there, based on maybe how you advertise or who you advertise the availability of these committees to, or other ways that you can imagine trying to recruit particular people. You can try to randomly select a population through some, lottery process, or you can designate, lay stakeholders or professional stakeholders who are educated, maybe unpaid citizens who have a deep interest. Think about people who are involved in a neighborhood association or school council, or professional stakeholders and those people who are paid for those positions. The second major thrust is how are the views expressed in those settings. So again, another spectrum of different activities, ways you can imagine expressing views. So on the least intense side of the spectrum, then people can just, there could be interaction between public and government, and people can just listen as a spectator. Or they can express their preferences, which I think is, again, where we sort of are right now. You can imagine a process where we develop people's preferences by providing them materials and organizing them in small groups and having them discuss and consider alternatives. And then you can imagine the more intense situations where people are aggregating and bargaining with each other and coming up with a single public voice that would then be expressed. And then the final section or the final prong here is, what is the impact of public participation? Do people simply get the personal benefits of being involved, learning about the process, feeling their civic obligation to talk? Or is there some kind of communicative influence where the members of government are actually trying to get information from? Or is there some more formal advisory and consulting process where opinions need to be more formally listened to, even as far as like a co-governance process in sort of the classic New England town hall meeting where the citizens all come together and with the, you know, with the people elected in front make a group decision about what they want. So thinking about those different aspects of institutional design, I just want to have Waleed and Diana comment on, you know, what they think, where they think we are right now, and where they think we could be, and then open up to questions and comments from the audience about where you guys think the optimal situation should be.
Okay, sure. I'll start. I will just say one of the things that our center is now doing is that we are training patients to understand science. Our hope is that when patients participate as advisory committee members or are speaking, that they will bring their perspective, which is unique to them, but also very important. One of the things I think that's really important about patient perspectives is that, you know, it's one thing to say, you know, as Waleed said, it's one thing to say, you know, this is ruining my marriage. It's another thing to hear somebody talk about what that means. So we think that these are very important, and they, and I'll use an example of antidepressants. Actually, there was a public meeting on antidepressants, trying to get certain antidepressants either off the market or not allowed for children, and the issue was that some kids were killing themselves or becoming very violent as a result of taking SSRIs, and they found that. In the data, it said that the kids were getting volatile or that their emotions were labile. And one of the examples of a child whose emotions were labile was a teenage girl who set herself on fire. Now, personally, I would call that a suicide attempt. She survived. But when she was asked, why did you set yourself on fire? She said, I don't know. So they called that labile, you know, and that doesn't convey, you know, that's an example where the data are not conveying what's happening. So we think that these perspectives are really important, but they need to be in the context of understanding that just because this drug was good for you or bad for you doesn't mean that that's true for most people, and understanding what a significance test means. So we've, you know, we've explained to people what a double-blind randomized clinical trial is and why that's important. We've also explained how sometimes you can't do that. You know, trying to teach patients to understand the science.
Yeah, I would say the more I thought about this, the more I realized I didn't really know what the answer is. And maybe that's why it's good for a seminar like this and to hear other people's thoughts. But I came up with the fundamental principle when I thought about it, which is we want to allow any person who is willing and able to have the opportunity to present. That may be one principle you might think about. The issue is, I think, like everything else in public involvement in the U.S., the more money you have and the more organized you are, the more likely you are to be heard. And that's a reality, you know, at the FDA, it's a reality in Congress, it's a reality everywhere. And so I think all public participation has the same problems. But fundamentally, you want anyone who wants to present to be able to present. And, you know, advisory committee members, we know people who are speaking and sometimes are paid. And so I think if you can't have a broad representation of everyone, then at least you know who they're representing. You know, and so that's the way I think about it, is let's let everyone present who can, understanding that not everybody will, and as long as we realize that that's okay. That's one way to approach it. There are a lot of other ideas about randomly selecting people, like juries. You know, maybe everyone who's in the clinical trial should agree that if the FDA, at the time of approval, they could be randomly called or if they're willing to present their experiences. But
I just wanted to add one thing, and that is that that we know that one of the tricks at these FDA public meetings is that because public comment speakers are asked, you know, basically, do you have conflicts of interest? We've seen situations where a patient will say, I paid my way to get here today, but they're reimbursed, you know, the next day. Something like that. You know, certainly one of the things that always amuses me are physicians who say, you know, I have no conflicts of interest, but my institution gets, you know, $5 million from this company. I mean, they don't say that part. So, you know, conflicts of interest are not just in the eye of the beholder, they're also easily disguised if that's a goal. And that's a real problem, I think.
So So maybe we'll now open it up to sort of commentary from the audience, and I see Dan's hand.
I've been on the receiving end of these public comments. I was on a three-person committee that was supposed to listen to 3 days of this stuff. And it quickly became apparent what was going on. Impassioned patients. And after a while, we could figure out who paid for them and who wrote their lines, all this stuff. So, of course, it had made no impression on us. But we couldn't say that because we didn't have any evidence. It was just it was perfectly obvious. But we dismissed it. Now, I think you both said that these advisory committees are being swayed. I just wonder what you think is going on in the minds of the members of the committee. Don't they see through this? And if they do, how could they be swayed by it? Do they feel that they have an obligation to be swayed because of how other people will be perceiving this? I mean, who's not in on the con?
I think I can only speak for myself. I will say that I agree that I think everyone on the committee knows what's happening. You know, the question is there anything to be gained still from what people say during the meetings? And I think knowing what you know, that they were paid to come, is there still some value to it? I don't think people are being conned. But when someone stands in front of you, looks at you, you know, says, my life has been ruined, this drug saved me, that does something to you, even if you know that they were paid by the company to come tell you that.
Yeah, and I would say and then imagine that sort of times 4 hours of sort of consistent 5 minutes at 5 minutes and 5 minutes, and you get a sense of what the eteplirsen committee was like with the committee members, because the room was too big. There was no big enough room at the FDA, I think. It was held at a hotel, and so there were literally 1,000 people in the audience who were kind of, you know, watching the interactions with the advisory committee. And I do think that, you know, that it is important to listen to patients, and I think that they provide a lot of you know, important color to the data, as Waleed was saying, and, you know, can provide some insights on various topics. But, you know, at some point, you know, is there a sort of diminishing return from the same point of view being said over and over again? And is there some benefit to trying to make sure that there is, other points of view expressed that may not be able to reach there? Maybe, you know, through, you know, some, you know, Skype or whatever else we're able to set up to try to, you know, recruit as broadly a coalition as possible.
And I would just like to add to that, I haven't been on an FDA advisory committee, but I am on the Medicare advisory committee. And it's hard to speak up when you're the only voice. And when you have a room full of people cheering when somebody says this drug is great and booing, as they did for the Duchenne's drug, booing when you say something they don't like, not everybody has the fortitude to say what they really think, let alone vote the way they like to vote. So it really, I'm pretty tough, and I've been a lone voice in the wilderness at a lot of these meetings. And I will say at the Duchenne's meeting, there were 50 public comment speakers all saying this drug is life-saving, you must approve it, and one person saying the science isn't there. That one person worked for me, and it was a horrible experience for her. And when she walked out of that room, some man followed her out, swearing at her. And we had another staff member who was with her, was, you know, walking with her, and this man threatened him and said, I should punch you in the face, old man. I mean, this was a volatile situation, and you know, and I have to deal with this as an employer. You know, thank God I wasn't there myself, because I don't like being in that situation either. But it's hard to have staff people who will do this work if they're going to be treated that way. And we were the only voice. And for the flibanserin meeting, I think we were one of 4 or 5, even though the other colleagues who agreed with us were all the women's health experts in the country on FDA issues, including the former head of the Office for Women's Health at FDA. So although there were a lot of nonprofits in this, even the SCORE campaign, it did not include the foremost experts on how FDA makes decisions on treatment. And even so, it ain't fun being one of four people.
Hi, so in full disclosure, my son is one of the 12 kids in the eteplirsen study, and I was at the AdCom, and I was one of the 51 speakers who spoke in favor of the drug. And I just have a question for everybody in the room. You know, if you're shopping for a product, who better to hear from than a person who has used that product? And so I kind of want to speak directly to you about the member of your group that was there and was the only one who spoke against the drug, and about the caliber of the folks who spoke for the drug. I think when we're talking about patients, we're talking about patients who are experienced on the drug. We were very careful as advocacy groups to make sure these weren't just patients who were pleading for something. Duchenne is fatal. We know Duchenne is fatal. That's not what you need to hear at an AdCom. What you need to hear is that this drug changed the course of the disease for my child. And 11 of the 12 children in the trial were represented, not only by parents, who potentially were seeing what they wanted to see, but by their treating clinicians who had treated these children from before they were on the drug to during treatment on the drug and currently. And these were world-renowned Duchenne experts. So I guess, you know, I'm feeling for you that you were one of the only negative groups in the room, but I think the reason for that is because there was great support for the drug. And why would somebody who had no experience with a particular drug want to speak during an open public forum? So I guess that's where I believe patient voice is important, clinician voice is important, real stakeholder voice is important, trained speakers to look at science. That's something that occurs elsewhere. So I think the right people were at that meeting speaking at that right time. And I'm very sorry that that the woman who you sent was harassed. I don't think that's representative of our community, but my son included was one of the people that made a lot of noise at that event. And I hope you understand that it was incredibly emotional because this is saving their lives.
Yeah, well, thanks. Thanks for that. Did you want to come?
Yeah, no, of course we understand that, you know, and any parent would understand that. I guess what I would say about our center is that we believe that if the company's data were that good, they would have provided data from the more than 90 patients that they were required to add to the study that had already been in the study at the time of the meeting. So why only talk about the data for the 12 patients when they already had data for 90 additional patients? So, you know, I'm really speaking from a scientific point of view. You know, if you only have 12 people in the study, there is a difference in terms of how well people react to certain drugs. Some two people of the 12 actually had a very bad experience, and the data will look a lot better when you take those people out in a post hoc way, but that's not the scientific way.
And again, I don't think we have the time or opportunity here to kind of get back into the weeds of the data themselves, but go ahead, Billy.
Yeah, and this just tells you the difficult job the FDA has, but I mean, patients have a very different experience with the drug than people looking at the data. I mean, I think that's what the bottom line is. And I think as advisors, it's important to understand both sides of it. I mean, a patient, for an individual patient, it works or it doesn't. You know, the issue is the FDA is not really deciding whether for you the drug works or not. And that's the tension, you know, but I think that it is valuable, and eteplirsen, flibanserin, whatever it might be, gets at this issue. I think it is important for advisors to understand that tension in the course of their evaluation, even while they look at objective data. But I think that's important.
So we have some comments over here. Apology.
Thank you very much. I'm very interested and what the two of you, or three of you, think about this question I have. Why would the FDA hold a public hearing on studies that included such small numbers of patients?
Yeah.
That's number one question. Number two question, isn't there some government regulation that should prohibit television advertising for medications that have no scientific background? I'm thinking particularly of that drug that improves your memory. I'm in that age group now, so I pay attention to that. But I tried to get the original studies that show this dramatic increase, improvement in memory, and the data are not available. Why does the FDA or the government allow that kind of advertising?
So, again, on your first question, I don't want to get into the weeds of, you know, why choices were made. I mean, this is a rare disease, and so it's hard to, you know, you need to be flexible in terms of how many people you expect in trials. But I think it does, I think I would like to try to rephrase your first question to ask, well, you know, why is the FDA holding these hearings, and what are they expecting to get, and what contribution are they hoping that the patient voice will make? And maybe I could pose that, sort of rephrase that slightly and pose that as well as if you did want to touch on the post-approval use and the, you know, sort of commercial speech advertising issues from drugs based on FDA decision-making.
Sure. And I, you know, I'm sympathetic to this question. It used to be that the FDA only had public meetings when a drug was really controversial, where it would, you know, it could go either way. And normally they, you know, I've never known them to ever have a public meeting for a drug that was only studied on 12 people without a control group. I've never known that to happen before. So I think it's a sign of the times, and it is an issue that I want people to think about, because it isn't just this one drug. How many drugs do you want to be considered when they are studied on a small number of people? Even though Duchenne's is a rare disease, other companies who have made products for the same condition had 100 patients or more in their study. So it's not like you can only get 12. So the FDA is under tremendous pressure from Congress now, and this has been going on for years. And they have been lowering their standards. That's why it used to be two double-blind randomized clinical trials. Now it's frequently one. Those of you who are scientists, you know, science depends on replication. If you've got one study, you don't have replication. So the standards have gotten lower. Every time FDA approves a drug, they put out a press release, you know, cheering how great this is. Somebody said that recently they've been approving 96% of the drugs that they're looking at, which would be great if these are all effective drugs, but not so great if they're based on preliminary studies. So, and the advertising thing, I'm not a lawyer, but the issue, we are one of two countries in the world that allow direct-to-consumer advertising, New Zealand being the other one. And supposedly it's a free speech issue, and that is why that changed some years ago, where before it wasn't allowed, and now it is. I don't know if you want to add anything.
I think there's a lot of questions. I'm happy
to. Yeah, that's fine. I'm happy to sort of take on more questions as well. So, yeah, go ahead.
Thank you very much. I'm Charlize Norman. I actually was on a medical devices advisory panel for about 6 or 7 years. And so I wanted to comment on the earlier comment about listening to the public and the fact that all the advisors, at least on the committee I was on, appreciated the comments but weren't fooled by some things. And I will state that I think most people didn't even think that if somebody was paid by a company, a patient to come and testify, so to speak, we didn't think that they were lying. You know, we knew that they really believed that. And so I just wanted to make that clear. It's not that any, you know, we're thinking, oh, they're all just, you know, doing that. I think it's very important part of the process for the panel members to hear that, because it is true. You look at the data. I'm a statistician, by the way, so I'm probably one of the few that don't have any conflicts on the actual advisory panel. I wanted to ask a question along a different lines, but related to the patient's voice in the product approval. And that is, I wanted to get the opinion of how you feel about the patients providing more input or more sway into the types of outcomes that are collected. You, Diana, refer to that in terms of quality of life, And we know these are competing risks because if you want to expedite a clinical trial, you use a biomarker because that you can measure that more quickly than an endpoint. But I personally would think there would be the design and the usefulness of many of these regulatory trials would be more raised to a higher level if we had those types of outcomes. And so I was curious of your response to that, whether you think there's more hope for that and whether or not that's going to happen in the future. Thank you.
Well, I'll just say, I mean, that was the point, and you probably know this, of the 20, 25 meetings that the FDA held on patient-focused drug development. This is a commitment from the FDA to figure out what are the symptoms for those diseases for which there are no treatments, or for those diseases in which the treatments do not actually make you feel any different. What are the outcomes that would be of benefit? So I think that those have been valuable, and I think, certainly if you think about flibanserin, there were a number of different outcomes, very controversial, but this issue of satisfying sexual events is a patient-reported outcome, and I think it's hard for any panel member to really conceptualize what that means, and that's where really hearing from a patient can be helpful. Again, even if you know they were paid by the company, they were probably one of the 10% who responded, and you just take that for what it is.
Yeah, and I agree that there's nothing like hearing from a patient to know what the benefit really is and what that feels like and what the risk really is, what the complications are and what that feels like. And what really concerns me about what FDA is doing now is because of the nature of who comes. And I agree with you. It's not like they're lying. It's just that you're only hearing one side of the story because that's who's there. So, what concerns me about what the FDA is doing is that they are paying a lot of attention to the benefits and to patients saying, I'm willing to take any risk and I don't care for this potential benefit. But I hear from a lot of patients who thought that until they had a bad response, and then they're really angry and saying, how could the FDA allow this on the market? This has ruined my life.
I'm struck by the dilemma that the FDA and the committees have a Herculean task. One of the things I've been looking at with a group of people here, certainly in forensic psychiatry, is how do people make decisions in settings of uncertainty? And we found that judges and jurors who are to evaluate the facts don't base their decision-making all the time, in fact, mostly, on irrational ways. The emotions always play a role. And so Dan's question, I think, is that it's really hard, even when you're sitting on a committee and you're faced with a bunch of people who have a bias, oftentimes, to not listen with an empathic voice, even though you're trying to listen to a statistical evaluation. And the question I have is how much effort, I think what you have an epistemological problem set up by virtue of having the public come, and that is, by and large, as you suggested, the public is coming with an emotional response, an advocacy position, with an expectation, and the expectation is that they will win. We've seen a lot of this in the current political scene here. Strong voices, big voices, bombastic voices with a single mind sway a lot of people. And I think that they come with an expectation, if we plea our case, how can you not be empathic? And so they're looking for an emotional response to what's going on. And the committee is sitting there trying to make a scientific evaluative decision made based on what are considered facts, and that can often be discussed in a variety of ways. I wonder if anyone, whenever there's a hearing, sets up directly before the discussion takes place what the parameters are, that in fact people are coming with different perspectives. And here is what the committee does. We're happy to listen to what you say, but clearly we know you have a perspective and we honor that, we trust it, we want to hear it. At the same time, understand that our decision-making is going to be based on the following. Does that happen regularly or does that just not happen?
Yeah, I would just quickly say that I've been to many, many advisory committee meetings where if somebody started to cheer or clap or boo, they were told by the chair, there will be no clapping,
There will be no booing, and if you continue this, you're going to be escorted out of the room. And I've never, until recently, had the experience of the kind of meetings where it's allowed for people to cheer and boo, because I do think it's very harmful to the scientific integrity of the meeting. And yes, people are emotional, but there are a lot of things in life where you're not allowed to cheer and boo loudly. It's, you know, it's not a football game. Oh yeah, they do that. Yeah, they'll say that, but then it doesn't matter if they say that if the emotions take over the room.
Good.
Yeah. I just want to say one thing, just for the sake of just thinking broadly, and I guess what I'll do is push back against this idea that we are objectively without emotion looking at facts and numbers, because we are on paper, but ultimately it's still about risk benefit. And the thing about the patient voice, and I'll just go back to flibanserin, the fact is that it increases it by one sexually satisfying sexual event per month. That is a fact. But is that a benefit or not? And is that a good enough benefit or not? And so that's where, you know, we'd like to think that we're just looking at numbers, you know, studies, what's the outcome. But ultimately, you still have to decide a benefit. And even MI, you know, a heart attack may be of different value to one person versus another. So I think just for the sake of...
And on a more sort of specific answer, like I think that there is right now very little framing of the advisory committee session and the patient voice in the advisory committee session to try, you know, relatively little is sort of charge to the advisory committee members about what it is that the patients are supposed to add or what they're supposed to get out of it. And so it can, you know, I'm sure it affects different people and different thoughts in different ways.
Yeah, and I'm sorry, I just want to add, you know, that the other side that they're not hearing is, you know, if a patient took the drug and drank alcohol and they thought, well, I just had one glass of wine, and then, you know, they were driving and, you know, they passed out and died, you know, you're not going to hear from that patient. Because there's nobody, you know, not just because they're dead, but because, you know, no family member is going to know, because they don't read the Federal Register, that this meeting is coming up. So that's the part
you're
not hearing.
Yeah, that's true. And I was going to react to Aaron's comment. I think that is true. We weren't given a charge for how to think about the patient voice. And, you know, when I was thinking more about this, I was thinking, should the patient speakers really be there when we're voting and deliberating? I mean, because part of this is the interaction between, and you can hear someone's opinion, but maybe you don't need them looking at you, you know, when you're trying to decide. Yeah.
So I have other discussion questions, but we also have only about 5 minutes left. So I mean, I think we still have some people who want to express opinions. So I think we should just keep going around. So Mike.
I just wonder about, is there value in maybe extending like delaying when the vote actually occurs because it's so emotionally charged, or a decision about, so what component, how much should today's proceedings influence our overall decision? Has there been thought about that?
The one thing I would say is, remember, the FDA is not deciding that day, but it is true the committee is voting, but it is a good idea. I mean, maybe it should be separated by at least a night to sleep on it or something.
I mean, there would certainly be complaints about, this is a public meeting, everybody's entitled to be there, and we should see the vote, you know, but you're right. If the vote were delayed, it could still be on a, you know, online or something.
I mean, it is, you're right. It is your government, and you know, you're the taxpayer. And so, you know, obviously there's a value to the sort of openness and transparency of it. And the accountability maybe that those people in the room also bring. Do you want to, there's a question hand in the back. Yeah.
Hi, I actually had a question for Dr. Zuckerberg. Earlier, you had mentioned that you're starting to talk with patients and do some education with them. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you're doing that education and if you find it effective.
Yeah, and I have some information I can hand out afterwards, too. We got a grant from PCORI, the Patient-Centered Outcome Research Institute, which was created by Congress as part of the Affordable Care Act, to look at research, comparative effectiveness research, and evidence-based medicine, with the idea that
If you had better evidence, healthcare would be more affordable and insurance would be more affordable. But we're training about 100 patients. It's open. Anybody can apply. They have to understand that the goal is to help people who want to be patient advocates and want to learn about the science. And, you know, those of us in this room, you know, we take a lot of things for granted in terms of what people know and what people don't know. So we evaluate our workshops to find out what they've learned and what they don't. And they're all learning, and some are learning more than others. But they certainly have an appreciation. I think what's important to us is they get that appreciation of why their own personal experience is important, but it is not the only thing, and how important it is to understand that a really horrible side effect that only affects 5% of the people using the treatment, if it kills them or ruins their life, that's something that really has to be taken into consideration. And that's why you need a decent number of people in any study to get those rare but horrible safety issues.
Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you to the panelists. It's been a very interesting talk. I had a question regarding the Public Advisory Committee in terms of the sense of intimidation you felt, some people speaking against newly sort of controversial drugs might feel. Do you think that there would be any value in there being the possibility to present one's thoughts in person but in a private setting, sort of just with the panelists, so that the sense of intimidation and fear against speaking against popular opinion can be eliminated?
I mean, it's an interesting idea. Are you suggesting that someone might come one at a time rather than having a whole room? I mean, that would change the dynamic, and that would still allow individuals to participate. That's an interesting idea. I hadn't thought about that. I mean, what I'll say is I hope that any person agreeing to be on an advisory panel is confident enough to know that they can look at the data and also, you know, and take in the patient perspective. But I know we're all human. But that is an interesting idea that I hadn't thought of.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an interesting idea, too. I think some of the other ideas that were expressed today on that vein were also interesting. I mean, I think that, you know, if the things continue in the, you know, if the flibanserin experience and the other and other experiences are signals of where this is now going to be in the future, and, you know, I think that those sorts of ideas may need to be more, you know, seriously taken up by the organizers of the committees and people will need to try to come to grips with trying to, you know, direct the passion and information that can be obtained in a way that makes it most, most effective. I mean, it's, you know, it's also theoretically possible that the sort of the model from the flibanserin, you know, provokes the exact opposite reaction in the way that Dan had explained earlier, of people thinking that this is, you know, all sort of a setup, and so it actually works in the opposite direction. So I mean, I think that ultimately, if this starts to become more and more of a social trend, then I think that, you know, we'll need to start to think about it and analyze it and consider these other options. So we're running towards the end of our time. I wanted to thank the panelists for coming, and thank all of you for being here as well. And to remind you about the upcoming ones in October and November, and I'd be happy to hear any feedback as well on the format so that we can continue to take public's opinion and adapt it into our expert decisions of how to handle these in the future. So thank you very much.